In 1968, when I first came up here on the river, it was a clear spring, and in about an hour of scuba diving, I saw 11 skeletons of mammoths and mastodons. These sinkholes in the bottom of this river are like a time machine. The sediments slowly stack up, and each layer is a little chapter. And what's neat from our point of view as explorers is that those wet sinkholes slowly backfilled as the ice ages ended. And the record of those sediments included earliest peoples, extinct animals, and this backfilling episode. And that's what we go in the river to excavate. Here in the Aucilla River and in the Aucilla, we've got about a dozen major sites, and we're continuing to work and daily find exciting new features about the earliest people. Then there was a 15-year lapse before we got back up here. The impetus was a bison skull with a spear point right in the frontal bone and part of a bison kill site. So it's a paleontologist and archaeologist's dream up here, once you learn how to get through the water to the bottom.
This site, Sloth Hole, is a focus of my master's and dissertation research. We have both a mastodon butchery from around 11,000 years ago and a campsite from around 10,000 years ago.
All right, the last bit of mapping of the contours of the unit we'll have to do, we'll start around Unit 57 where the tusks came out, and as we work to the north, we'll cover the units where the worked ivory came from.
That was recovered in intact sediments in another section of the Aucilla River here that ended up being 7.5 foot long, and it was preserved exquisitely in sediments that had stained it golden orange colored, and it was just a magnificent experience to be there as the excavators slowly uncovered the sediments millimeter by millimeter until this glorious tusk glowed orange in the otherwise dark water on the bottom.
The thrill of the discovery is every day always with us, because we are constantly running into either butchered bones of an articulated mastodon or some of the other pieces, such as an ivory foreshaft fragment that we found just a few days ago. Only one implement like this has been found west of the Mississippi, and here at Sloth Hole we've covered 60 fragments that seem to represent about 35 tools like this one. This example is 33.3 centimeters long, and when complete would have been about 40 centimeters long, making it far and away the largest ivory object that's been found in North America.
Some of the things that come out of the river are very special. The lithic points, like the Clovis points, the classic Western ones, but then a lot of Florida varieties, Swanee points, Bolin points, stuff through time that culturally evolved. Also, we get very special preservation of bones, ivory, and wood that's sealed off in the river sediments. When we first find them, sometimes they turn brown on exposure to oxygen or sunlight, but they're beautiful.
All right, I got enough pigment now. I think it should match pretty good.
Okay, looks good.
Being able to cast these things and distribute them to other scientists and share the information without having the object travel, it's a very delicate object.
Okay, looks like a good color match on the ivory.
All right, we just got to fill the barb right now. Okay, and if you can tap that and get the bubbles out of the end of it. Should run out a little bit, but not too bad.
Well, here we have a cast of a barbed ivory piece from very nearby. The barbed ivory piece is very important because, as far as we know, it's unique, and it's clearly a point. It's not part of the foreshaft or point debate that rages among archaeologists.
There you go. Tap it a little bit. And that should be full, so it should be okay now.
These are finished casts of the very large Clovis point and the barbed ivory point, which now can be put on display in the exhibit hall or can be sent to other scientists worldwide for comparative purposes.
The satisfaction that I've received in my 30 years in this river, and indeed the whole project has received in the last 15 of very intense work, is impossible to describe. The museum and people of the future will benefit from this, but I think those of us that were directly involved are very, very privileged.
The Florida Museum of Natural History was chartered by the legislature in 1917, so that makes us over 80 years old at the present time. Since that time, it has grown to become the largest collection-based museum in the southeastern United States and probably the most comprehensive university-based natural history museum in the country. So the citizens of Florida should be quite proud of this institution that has grown to such enormous capacity in 80 years.